Before we start, as you saw from the title of the video, this tutorial is mainly about WebGL. But because we're exporting GLB format, this tutorial would work also for AR as well, because AR also uses GLB format. And the general requirements for optimization for WebGL and AR are pretty much the same. And just to say quickly, what defines good optimization for WebGL and AR? To give a comparison, if when we are downloading the game, we expect the game to download for a certain amount of time. We expect it to take a long time, so we would wait. But when it comes to WebGL and AR, we don't really have that time. People are surfing through the internet, they are surfing through the application, and they want quick responsiveness. So we need the model to load quickly. And to achieve that, we need to do optimization not only on the geometry level and on the textures level as well. And I would say textures are even more important if you don't have like a crazy amount of polygons, because textures take around 90% of the file size at least, like sometimes even more. So yeah, let's start talking about the mesh wire, the polygon count. This part is pretty straightforward. There is nothing really to talk about that a lot. The main rule is to keep your model simple in terms of polygon count. Do not overload it with polygons. Remember that vertex, polygon, it's still a information for CPU and GPU to process. And if we're going to have a lot of polygons, the CPU and GPU would need to process them. And it would also add to loading time of our model. So yeah, depending on the project, you would have less limitations or more. Again, always it is the project that defines it. If you have more logic, like a physics maybe using in your application, that means you have more on CPU load, and you cannot have that amount of polygons that you wanted to have. And if you have just a WebGL viewer, when you go on the website, you're just like watching one model. Of course, that would be the best scenario for having a high quality 3D model with a lot of polygons. As a general rule, if you have the model optimized, it is better. So yeah, try to keep it simple. And let's talk about these values, the rotation and scale. These are also pretty important. I suggest applying these values. So rotation and scale, like rotation is by 0 and scale by 1. In my experience, they don't really hurt the model. Like it won't do anything if this is not applied. But occasionally, it can do some bad things, especially if you have some kind of a logic attached to that model, and logic somehow uses the scale value to do some operations, and it might affect badly. So when it comes to the origin, aka pivot point for 3ds Max users, most of the time I put it in the bottom center. Like in most of the projects that I worked, this is the place that we use. But again, it depends on what you need. You might want to put it in the bounding box center, or maybe like in a specific spot. But most of the time, we use it like in these places, in the bottom center of our model. So yeah, this part is pretty much finished. There is not really much to talk about the geometry if you have the model finished. And the next part, we gonna talk about the textures. And this is the part that we really need to pay attention, because if we just download the model from the internet, it would have high quality textures, which people expect to get when they buy a model. Before we take these textures and import them into the Blender, let's pay attention to one thing: the overall size of these textures. It is 9.2 megabytes, which is not really good for a WebGL model. Most of the time, like from my experience, it is really good to have the model like around from 3 to 5 megabytes. If it is even lower by maintaining the quality, then of course it is even better. But these textures, we surely need to optimize them. And there are different ways to do that. First is to reduce the size of these textures, not the size, the resolution, or convert them to another format, like more compressed format. In current, like on these models, these, as you see, they are PNG, and we could convert them to JPEG, which of course would reduce a lot on the size of these textures. And there is also one thing that we can do is to use compression. And I will show you one website, which is a really great website. Let me drag it from my second monitor. And this texture, I mean, sorry, this website allows you to do various kind of things on the textures. For example, we can convert to JPEG all of the textures that we're going to drag here. And let's do the conversion. Now it is currently converting all of the textures to JPEG, and we're straightforward going to continue to compress them. Here, I'm going to press it. And you see, it already shows the size of these textures. Like, base color was before around 4 megabytes. After making it to JPEG format, converting it, it already lost a lot of it, a lot of file size. Let's compress these images, and as you see, it reduced the file size even more. Now download these compressed images and save them. So now open the archive, and let me just move the base color and ORM texture over here. And let me delete these textures, which are the bigger versions of these. And for the neural map, I'm not going to take this over the compressed neural map. And the reason for, I'm going to explain it right now. The neural map is really fragile when it comes to any kind of optimization. Because it affects the shading of our model, it can easily create some kind of artifacts in our model if we do like over optimization or over compression on the neural map. So what we're going to do? I'm actually going to show you also the example of the compression, and I have this model here. Let me quickly grab the model. This one, this is the model without the compressed neural map. And as you can see, it looks pretty normal without any issue. We have these like chamfered edges and everything, which are coming from neural map. And let's use the compressed texture now. The model with compressed texture. And as you could see, I hope you could see that on the YouTube video. I hope the YouTube video compression doesn't really destroy the quality. You could notice that a lot of these speckles, a lot of these lines that appear on the model, and this is pretty simple model as well. For example, if you're gonna have the like hard surface details like hinges and stuff on the neural map, it will be visible by a lot. So be aware when optimizing neural map, check different methods of optimization and do testing. Just check how the neural map looks, because in my experience, sometimes just converting to JPEG for neural map works better. Sometimes without converting to JPEG, just compressing works better. But both of them, in my experience, does a bad thing. But again, sometimes it works fine as well if you do both of them. But for this model, I already did testings, and just compressing neural map works better. So I would go here, compress image, and take the neural map and drag it over here. Compress image. So we get the PNG model, but the compressed one. As you could see, like, it reduced the file size by 3 times, which is a really great reduction. Just a quick note, sometimes you may want to do the conversion to JPEG not through the website, but through the Photoshop. The upside of doing it through the Photoshop is that you can control the quality of the neural map. For example, I'm going to switch here to JPEG. And when I'm saving, I can control actually the quality of the JPEG that I'm exporting. And sometimes it is useful to do it that way rather than doing through the website, which is just automated process. Just wanted to add that quickly. So yeah, let's remember the previous file size, which was around 9.2 megabyte, and now it is 1.5, which is really, really great for WebGL. And now let's import the textures to Blender. Import base color, normal, and orange. The shader setup is pretty straightforward. We're gonna use the base color and input it over here into the base color. The neural map, we need the normal map node for it to work correctly and assign it here into the normal input. But there is also one thing that we need to do with neural map texture. We need to switch the color space to non-color. And now it works fine without any artifacts. The same we're gonna do for the ORM texture as well. We're gonna switch color space to non-color. And if you're not familiar with the concept of ORM texture, it is simply one texture that contains three different textures in each color channel. So textures like ambient occlusion, roughness, metallic, these are grayscale textures. And the channels that defines the color of the image are also grayscale. So we can take the each texture and assign them into the each channel. And we get the texture that has three different textures in three different channels. And what we need to do now, we need to create a node that allows us to separate these channels from each other by this node. So now we have access to red, green, and blue channel. Let's take green channel first and apply it here to the roughness. And blue would be metallic. The order is pretty simple to understand, like ORM, occlusion, roughness, metallic, with the same order with red, green, and blue. Now, as you may have noticed, there is no such input named ambient occlusion in a principled BSDF shader. So what we need to do now, we need to create a node that would allow the GLTF exporter to recognize the ambient occlusion input. So let's do that. Let's create a node. Let's create the, like, we can start with any type of node because we are doing a custom node. I prefer just using attribute, the one that comes up the first after type letter A. I would press the Ctrl G button and I would delete this attribute. And I would go like over here to the right. If you don't have this window, press N and delete all of the outputs because I don't need them. I need only an input. So I create an input and by double clicking, I would rename it to occlusion. Make sure to name it correctly because the GLTF exporter gonna look for that input on the node and try to export the ambient occlusion with the model. And there is also one thing that left to do is to rename it over here. So let's name it GLTF settings. So yeah. We created a node which would be recognized by the GLTF exporter and it would assign the ambient occlusion texture to the material. And this is pretty much everything that we need for our model. So I would say the WebGL AR model is set up and we can export it now. So we go here, go to GLTF. And let's start exporting. So when it comes to export settings, over here, I don't really touch anything. Just in case if you want to export one model, for example, you have like 10 models in your scene and you want to export only one model, you can select the specific one and check the selected objects. But there are things that I do most of the time before exporting, is I would uncheck the vertex colors. By default, you would have vertex colors checked. I would uncheck them because I don't have vertex colors and I don't use them. And animation over here would have animation shape keys and skinning turned on by default. I would turn off them as well. But the reason why I removed them, I just wanted to explain, is sometimes when you import the model from another software, you can get like these animated keys for each frame. It's like some models have them for some reason. So just in case if I miss those animations and I forgot to remove from the model, so I do that so I accidentally don't export these animations. That's the reason. So just I want to let you know that even if you have these parameters checked, you would still don't export any animations if you actually don't have them in scene. So yeah, we can export it. And just as a quick note, you have different options to export GLB, GLTF, or GLTF separate. Most of the time, in my experience, the GLTF binary is used, so GLB model, and I would keep that. So let's export the model. And yeah, as you see, this model is the one that we just exported. And the file size is pretty low, which is really, really good for WebGL. 1.6 megabyte, it's gonna load really quickly on any WebGL engine and gonna download really fast in any AR app, which makes our model very well optimized. So, let me do one thing quickly. Let me turn on the Baby Launch JS Viewer again. And let's drag our model just to see how it looks. And as you can see, it looks pretty well. We have all of the neural map data. Let's switch lighting. Yeah, as you see, we have all of the neural map data, all of these wrinkles over here. And the model itself is looking good. And as you can see, the metallic part is also looking fine. Because we did only one compression on the neural map. And regarding the compression of neural map, most of the time, what I noticed is that the metallic surfaces and the glossy surfaces, these are the type of surfaces that take a really big hit from the neural map compression. And if you have a model which is mainly consist of metallic parts, it would have a really bad impact if you compress the neural map. So maybe you better be using the mid-poly model with the metallic parts, or as well with the high glossy parts. So generally the parts that have a lot of reflections, it can really show the bad shading of the model. When the model is rough, it's harder to see the shading issues on the model. The more glossy the surface is, it is easier to notice the shading issue. This is like the main concept why we can see the compression issues on the neural map. And I would say, yeah, that's pretty much it for this tutorial. Thanks for watching and have a great day.